Professor Jonathan Carapetis is Director of the Telethon Kids Institute, which you will know is WA's largest medical research organisation. He's a paediatrician and infectious diseases specialist whose research interests and focus in his current role is all about better health outcomes in the future for kids and ultimately for their families as well, including through research programs in nutrition, diabetes and obesity. Please welcome him. I thought it would be really interesting to get your reactions on some of the key things that have come up in the sessions this morning. And the first one was about the question that Barry actually put up about whether we were using data well enough. Yeah. And we kind of said, well, we may be a little bit fair, good. We were in that kind of department. Are we? How well are you using data and how's it working for you?
Really well. We are... I mean, that's the basis of who we are. We're a research organisation. So I think probably most importantly is how can we provide data to others to use it to do useful things, such as make policy, improve practice. And that's something that we're trying to do much better at. We've had a long-standing relationship with policymakers, service providers in this state, nationally. We've been around for getting close to 30 years trying to do that. But in the past, I think researchers have tended to live in their research academic bubble far too much. They've tended to use data to focus on peer-reviewed journal publications, for example, which are, you know, incredibly important and wonderful markers of excellence, but probably mean very little to a lot of the people in the room here. What's more important is how we then take the next step, which is to make sure that evidence is relevant and useful and provided to people who can use it. And that's something that we've been, particularly over the last few years, working much harder at. And I guess the epitome of how we've done that in the past and how we're going to try and do it better in the future is data linkage, which was mentioned earlier. And Western Australia has led the country, indeed in many ways led the world in data linkage in the past. Over the past probably decade, we've gradually come back to the pack. We've had a data linkage review which has been released by government, which really outlines a plan for how we can return to that leadership role and really use the existing data much more effectively. And I think that's what Barry was trying to say in many aspects. We need to get that thing implemented and use the data, and that's where organisations like us can, if you like, come behind those making policy.
Yeah. So across what you've heard this morning, has it all resonated with your views and experiences? Has it been a matter of kind of sitting here vehemently agreeing with everything?
Yes, with one minor exception, which I'll get onto in a sec. But what has been really intriguing for me, and the thing that probably has preoccupied my thinking a lot in the last couple of hours, listening to what we've heard, is, you know, the point's been made. We've got lots of evidence. We're all, I think, in furious agreement around the fact that something needs to be done, and we've got a pretty clear idea about what needs to be done. What I don't think we've really nailed is why isn't it being done? And in a way, that's why it's probably quite good, because we could have a chat because the minister's left the room. Although I noticed that one of his people's here, so we'll be careful. But, you know, I'm just trying to understand, and there's a lot of you in the room who know more about this than me, about what's going through his mind and what's going through the minds of a new government. This is such an opportunity with a new government, and the people I've met in this government, by and large, are incredibly devoted to trying to do something useful, to take the opportunity to set a new course. I think we've heard very clearly the message that this, you know, focusing on a comprehensive approach that is quite bold around obesity would be electorally incredibly appealing. And so if you ask me, it's not an issue of should we do it and would that be a really good thing for our standing in the community. It's me having to personally understand better why wouldn't it happen? What's stopping this government from doing the eight things that have been outlined and that Maurice also outlined? What really is stopping that from happening right now? Because if you're willing to take on the commercial interests, which I think is probably the one message we're getting, that's the big block, if you're willing to take them on and you accept that the economic there will be economic benefit from doing this, not economic loss from doing this, then just be bold. And that's what I would hope out of this. It's not just preaching to the converted and we just say, yes, we'd like to do something, and then one or two small things is done. It's What opportunity does a state have to do, even if the Commonwealth decides they're going to drop the ball? What's stopping a state from saying, well, we're going to do whatever we can in the meantime? And that's probably what I'm not quite getting.
So who do you appoint as the champion?
Well, we have a minister here who has clearly convened this summit, who, from what I'm gathering, is wanting to do something significant. I think you need, and this is where I'm interested in Jane's views also on the task force. So there's this idea of, one of the eight national aims is to have a task force. Now, task forces come and go, and I've been part of task forces that have been incredibly frustrating because they don't have teeth, and there are no indicators, there are no targets, etc. So why don't you do that in Western Australia and say, let's have a Western Australian obesity task force, and let's identify the comprehensive strategy. But within the comprehensive strategy, you've got to identify some really big ticket items you can tick off, and let's set some targets to it. I think that's the sort of thing that gets people excited, rather than the tinkering at the edges, which we can continue to do with some fantastic initiatives like Live Lighter. That's great, but in itself, it's not doing what we need it to do, which is really change the whole paradigm in this state.
Mm. I want to go down to some more kind of nitty-gritty stuff, particularly where we've talked about children quite a few times, and one of the questions, which I haven't got anything on my screen at the moment, I'm hoping that's right.
I asked it.
In terms of...
Can I?
Oh, you asked it, did you? It was a plant.
I'm glad you picked it up. So it's the question that, just picking up Jane's comment around... we should be targeting adolescents in preference to young children, and that's... So I'm going to try and reword the answer, because I'm sure that's not what you meant, which is to say that, and I couldn't agree more, that in public health in general, we have completely neglected adolescents, we've completely neglected young people. And I work in an area, a particular disease called rheumatic heart disease, where there's a perfect example of that. But it's true of mental health, it's true of drugs and alcohol, it's true of obesity, nutrition, the list will go on. So I think what you're saying is that we have to make sure that is a significant part of whatever our response is. Because there's no doubt that as you go through the life course, your chance of making a biggest difference to outcome as an adult starts prenatally. It begins in those first couple of years, and that's where the biggest chance of making a difference is. It gradually reduces. By the time you get out of adolescence, you've kind of lost the chance to do something significant at a population level. That's not to mean that there are not going to be individuals who can be turned around. But we heard in the opening remarks that when it comes to tobacco, your chance of actually stopping someone smoking is so much less than stopping them starting in the first place. So my feeling is that I can give you reams of evidence that we need to be focusing in young children and obviously the environment in which they live, which is also includes focusing on parents and families. That's the most important. We've got, I think the figures are 30% of 2 to 5-year-olds in Western Australia don't get the recommended amounts of physical activity. 20% are already overweight and obese. Mm. So the pattern is set then. Intervene then, but don't lose track of the fact that, yes, there's also this additional transitional period in life, which is adolescence, when you've got another chance to do something significant.
Mm. And
is that a reasonable summary of...
Is that
good?
The answer you wanted to give? How effective are kids at kind of creating new thinking inside families, like where the children are bringing home the messages and their new messages to the parents, but it can really transform a family?
It's limited, because it's usually the parents and the family that parents set the example, and in fact the kids usually respond to the environment around them. What kids can do, and this is another really difficult balancing act that I have as a parent, is they can introduce some interesting technological solutions. And there are some really interesting technologies. And a lot of the discussion today has been so far a lot around the inputs, it's around the basically poor nutrition. But let's not lose the fact of the other bit, which is the physical activity. And there are some wonderful new technologies around encouraging kids to do physical activity. So I've got, we bought a smart trampoline a year ago, and our kids actually go out there and they use it because there's this iPad that tells them they squish fruit on the trampoline. It's a game. So turning activity into a game is something that's that kids can teach us about and we can offer the opportunities for them to do. Of course, the balance then as a parent is how do you balance that against your desire to get them off the screens in the first place? And so it's not easy. But I think the ability for, I think as adolescents, there's the ability to really focus on how can they be empowered to ask questions around the home, because, and that's where I think the comment around schools is really important. If they're getting messages at school around what's a healthy lifestyle, what's the right amount of bad foods to and good foods to eat, what's the right amount of alcohol to drink, then they can ask those questions at home. And then how do we empower the parents to say, yeah, maybe we should change the way we model.
There's a question here. Instead of feeling overwhelmed, it's important to select what is working and do more of this. What do we choose, or how do we choose?
I actually think that's a fantastic point. And indeed, it's a point I've been trying to make recently around closing the gap. Sorry to sort of slightly divert to another issue, but that's another issue that's overwhelming. It's about trying to change an entire society, and that's not just the Aboriginal society, it's also how the rest of this community deals with Aboriginal people. And I believe one of the reasons we are not making progress is that it's just becoming too big and too hard. And how do we hone down on something that's much more tangible, that can lead to significant change that we can take credit for? So that's why I think, you know, there's no doubt that focusing on the tax on sugary drinks is an absolutely blindingly obvious thing to really focus on, because, boy, that would be a big win and it'd be a really important win. And you can say that's an important step, but you cannot let it be the be-all and end-all. It has to be part of this overall comprehensive strategy, because we've heard from Maurice that silver bullets don't work.
And when you talk about a tax on sugary drinks, what size of a tax are you talking?
I'll have to ask the expert.
20%.
There you go, 20%.
Tons, as much as possible. I mean, that sounds like it should be quite a straightforward thing, but in fact that's kind of turned out to be the nub of the whole barrier, in the sense that you have to work against the industry, food and drink industry lobby. Have you come across these people directly?
We have, and we certainly come across them. I mean, what was interesting, and I think I can see Carol Bauer up in the audience maybe, but there's this idea of the folic acid discussion that we heard before that did come with some resistance from industry. That was able to be turned around because it probably wasn't as big a deal and certainly as big an industry as we're talking about with the sugary drinks. We certainly get it with the alcohol industry, and I think this afternoon's discussion is going to be really informing around that, because we worked very closely with the women of Fitzroy Valley, who were the ones who were instrumental in bringing in regulations to take away alcohol, and boy, the difficulties they had, and that wasn't just from the alcohol industry, it was from local traditional owners who had vested interests, but they fought through, so you've got to be tough. As we move into bigger questions, which is in Port Hedland, which is not just a purely Aboriginal community, how do you deal with that? That gets tough. That's where I think it's really important to come back to two big things, one of which is what's the level of community support to do something, to reassure those who are trying to push this through that whilst they're champions, they also have the backing of the community. We've got to keep doing that. And then the other thing we haven't done well enough is make that case for why this is a good investment. Everybody puts these things in terms of what's the cost going to be, either the cost to do it or the lost income from other things, such as the revenues you get from selling this stuff and the taxation revenues, etc. Well, think about it the other way around. Think about all these investments in health as actually cost saving in the long run, and we need much better data, and there are people who can help us get this data about the fact that if we did a couple of these things on this list, the net benefit to the economy of Western Australia fairly quickly, but certainly in the next 20 to 30 years, is going to be huge. And that's the discussion that we don't have enough.
Yeah. Well, maybe we should take a leaf out of the Women of Fitzroy's book and use them as our guide for resilience and determination. But I know we're going to be hearing from you at the end of the day again, but thank you so much for now. And I shall hand back to Griffin. Thank you so much.